I want to get into the area now of multi-party negotiations, and I will discuss briefly as a part of that really a third-party intervention procedure facilitation. We won't go into mediation or any of that, obviously. Really, for purposes of definition, a multi-party negotiation is any negotiation of more than two persons or entities, each representing its or their own interests. The aspects that I want you to consider include coalitions, which we'll discuss briefly, group behavior, and then we'll go briefly into areas such as reg-neg, but only briefly, intergovernmental negotiations. You've heard of crisis management. That really, in a way, is a third-party a multi-party negotiation, because you usually have the subject and the hostages and the negotiator. And you have collective bargaining, which we've already covered. The topic is very broad. I'm only going to focus really on coalitions, because that's the part that I think you really should know about and understand. The first thing I would look at is coalitions and tips involving multi-party negotiation, because multi-party negotiation, whether it's in companies or Congress or wherever, requires coalition building, and I think that's the heart of the way to approach this topic. Entering into a multi-party negotiation means thinking ahead about offense, how to build the winning coalition, and defense, how to organize a blocking coalition that could thwart other parties' aggressive moves. Now, that sounds all very warlike, but it can all be encompassed within a cooperative framework if you think about it. Coalitions are subgroups, really, of a bigger group. For example, in Congress, the Democratic Caucus would be a subgroup of the entire Congress. We know that there were groups within the Democratic Party that formed, I can't remember what they call them, the Blue Dogs, I think, which was, again, a coalition. As we know from reading newspapers, coalitions, both in government and non-governmental bodies, may cooperate with each other, or they may compete with each other, or they may have shifting alliances, and that is the whole strategy underlying negotiations as between coalitions, and that's really what we're going to talk about briefly. Unlike two-party negotiations where BATNA, ZOPA, Pareto's superior, may be easy to establish, in multi-party negotiations, you may have to reevaluate or question whether even those concepts are initially applicable. There may be situations where there is no immediate best alternative to an agreement. However, as in two-party negotiations, in multi-party negotiations, the parties can discover a trading zone. That moment in the negotiation when the adversaries may switch, if only briefly, to become collaborative. In other words, they're willing to trade this for that and become collaborative, even if momentarily, so that an agreement can be reached. We see this in Congress all the time. If you just want to study this field, just follow what Congress is doing at any time, or any state legislature. And if you're out of the United States, think of activities within your own government, where a coalition forms and then, even for that moment, shifts from being primarily competitive to being willing to cooperate, you actually have integrative bargaining. I think there are different techniques that we should consider, because I'm focusing, as I say, mainly on coalitions in this topic. There's so much you could cover in this, it's unbelievable. I think there are different techniques to consider. First of all, the behavior patterns of the parties. It's important that coalitions are careful in selecting their partners and opponents. This is sort of a divide and conquer type of an approach, but really it's important that each coalition carefully evaluate which other group it should be associated with. Behaviorally, they should think carefully how and when to meet one-on-one with other parties. If two parties form, two groups, we'll say, form a coalition and are going to meet with a third group, when are they going to meet one-on-one? When are they going to disclose their coalition? All those sorts of elements. If a coalition is formed between several parties, it's really important, normally, that one party manages it so that if in an organization, say, three or four little groups get together, they better select a chairperson. And it's important that that chairperson try to avoid the appearance of process opportunism, that they don't compete for the role of chairperson. It's very important within the coalition, as well as in dealing outside the coalition, that the rules and the process are very clear. There has to be clear on decisional rules. For example, are the members of the coalition bound by majority rule? Are they bound by consensus? What's the rule? And you have a risk in any coalition of one party deciding they're better than the others or whatever, and attempting to wrench control of agenda of the negotiation by the coalition. So you have that to consider. One author that I read suggests there are roles within the coalition. There, it sounds very militaristic or governmental, but they're the scouts. They're the go-betweens who go fetch relative material. They get the statistics. They get the reports as required by members of the coalition negotiating team. There are the ambassadors. Those are the people who acquire resources for the group and obtain additional input, and they act as a link to senior management of the group to keep them appraised, but do so informally. There are the coordinators, this writer suggests. These are all somewhat fantasy. These individuals provide a more official link with groups outside the coalition, as well as the stakeholders within. For example, in a company, the coalition and a board of directors may be using that coordinator to deal with the CEO. And there are guards, according to this author, to ensure the security of the information that isn't to be revealed to the other participants outside the coalition. So you have all of those elements if you want to accept that sort of that approach to behavior patterns within a coalition. I sort of get a kick out of it, and that's why I quoted it to you. There are behavior patterns that do go on, and we have discussed them in individual negotiations. We've discussed them and connect them with collective bargaining, and it's trade-offs. Or log rolling. This is really an integral part of multi-party negotiation. If you remember, trade-offs are where you give up a less important element of a deal in order to get what you consider to be a more important. And in Congress, they call it log rolling because somebody will give up something for his or her congressional district in return for something bigger that they may want, and things of that nature. It's really the same in two parties as it is in multi-parties. There's this reciprocal trade-off between either a group or two groups. It may be that there's trade-offs even to form the coalition, and then that coalition, when formed, makes trade-offs with another group or another coalition, because you can have more than one coalition within a group. As you can see, game theory can play a huge part in multi-party negotiations. Because remember, with computers and with algorithms, game theory can attempt to establish what the coalitions are and what the outcome is going to be depending upon assumptions and variables regarding the various coalitions, even though they may not be directly related to the overall process. So game theory has become very important in international affairs, for example, where, say, the Palestinians and the Iranians form a coalition. I'm just making this hypothetically. And you want to know what the outcome would be vis-a-vis, the Israelis and the United States. Algorithms can be developed, and it's way over my head, and I'm not going to go into it, obviously, but who can predict the outcome of those types of coalitions. There are sequencing alternatives that have to be taken into account. For example, in building coalitions, who speaks to whom first? Which little group speaks to which other little group? All of those things that come in sequencing. And by the way, I should mention, although again it's a mathematical computation, there is a paradox known as the Condorcet paradox, which can show you mathematically that in majority rule elections, the winners of certain issues will change as a function of the order in which the issues are raised and voted on. So that, and don't ask me to explain that, I can say it, but I can't mathematically show it. But I do know that it can work, because if you have three or four issues, you can literally bring up one issue that may prevail with a majority vote, and in effect, that will have effect on all the other issues that come up. Now, I didn't know that was the Condorcet paradox, but I have seen things like that take place in nonprofit organizations, for example, where either intentionally or unintentionally, the parties have decided to vote on one issue, which may preclude a majority vote on another issue. Another thing that may happen in coalition building is there may be strategic misrepresentations in the same way there are between individuals. A coalition or a group within a coalition may attempt to misrepresent their position, or they may vote for the least preferred option that is available, because then they'll think that if they vote for that, which is, say, third on the list, that maybe another option will be defeated and the first choice will win. There are all sorts of games that can be played, and they are played in Congress and in other legislative bodies and even within organizations. So much for coalitions. You should be aware that there are different ways to vote. And I should mention that to you, because that's really a part of multi-party negotiation. We're mostly familiar with majority rule as opposed to plurality rule. Any of you who know Robert's Rules of Orders know that is premised on the fact that in any vote, a majority, that's 51%, or anything over 50%, wins. There is another method of voting, which is plurality voting, which says in effect that even though a party does not get a majority, this would obviously be where there are more than two issues or candidates, whoever gets the highest vote wins. That's a plurality vote. And there is a third method, which has been pushed by a guy named Lawrence Susskind, which is known as consensus approach, which is that you get a consensus of the group, and then you rely on the census. Some of us call it a straw vote. The in voting, There are all sorts of ways to play around. There are main motions. There are secondary motions. There are motions that are privileged. For example, if I have the floor and move the table, that precludes all other discussion. If I move to call the question, that can foreclose any further debate. There are motions that bring decided issues back onto the floor. There is a whole body of rules and procedures that accompany either majority voting or plurality voting, and you should be just aware of it. If there is consensus voting, where there's no plurality and no majority, there has to be some sort of a rule made as to who decides what the consensus is. It could mean unanimity, in which case the only way you ever get a decision is for everybody to agree. Or it could mean whatever the chair thinks sounds like most people are in favor of it, which is another approach. There is another technique which San Francisco is famous for. It's called ranked choice voting, where you have more than two candidates. You actually vote for all the candidates, and you rank them 1, 2, 3, 4. And then if there is no majority winner, number four, in other words, the one who got the fewest votes, we'll say it's number four, is taken off the list. That candidate's first place votes are moved up to first place, and then the votes are recounted. So it's a ranking of the choice. It has worked for their board of supervisors up there. I've used it for nonprofit organizations. It's a workable. There are objections to it, and there are whole articles on it. And once when I taught this course, I had a student who emailed me and told me if I was really interested, he'd written a book on it. And I can believe it because it's almost all mathematically studied again. There are various variations of ranked choice voting, and there are pros and cons. If you're ever interested in it, there's an awful lot on the internet about it. Now that really, I'm sort of skimming over multi-parties because the real guts of multi-party negotiation comes up with in the international field. And we're really then getting into third party type of negotiations as well, or third party intervention rather. One thing I should mention is Reg-Neg, which is becoming very popular. We already have in our government here, and most foreign governments I think, various rulemaking procedures where before an administrative board puts out a rule, they have a hearing. They invite everybody who's interested to come and comment on the rule. And once they get all the comments, the board sits down and makes its own decision as to what the rule should be. Recently in the United States, we have had what's known as Reg-Neg, or regulation negotiations, which is a little different because in agencies that have this procedure, there actually is a negotiation in which all interested parties are invited to attend, just like in a rulemaking procedure. But once they have met and they all present their views, there is a vote taken. And whatever that group determines should be the regulation becomes the regulation. So that in effect, the group as a whole as a multi-party negotiation, has negotiated the terms of the regulation. And it's got all sorts of possibilities that I think will evolve as the law becomes more well-known and more implemented. But it's a really interesting approach to doing governmental regulations. I think I've already discussed, active learning. As I mentioned, it's also called appreciative inquiry or appreciative learning. There are organizations, appreciative inquiry is one, it's called AI, which has a whole organization. It's got a website devoted to their activities. There's a group out of Cleveland, I believe, that also is into active listening or appreciative listening, whatever you want to call it. This is an area that really is a case of where what we've discussed in two-party negotiations, where active listening is an important role at arriving at a collaborative agreement. These are groups that are using it often with facilitators or instructors to try to get people to listen to each other, to actively learn from what the others have to say, create a non-defensive, constructive environment for negotiation. And there are various approaches to it. It's a really interesting area. If you want to read about it, again, there's quite a bit of material on the internet, and I'm skipping over it because of that. Finally, I have mentioned facilitation. Really, facilitation is an area that some of you should probably look at. The really successful facilitators these days are actually making a living. There are three types, and facilitation, basically, before I start on the types, is a situation where a group is brought together, say a whole company, a whole organization, maybe members of two organizations, whatever. A single facilitator, usually it's a single facilitator, will act as the facilitator to get the parties to negotiate among themselves as to things, and he is the guide or she is the guide. There are three types, really. There are groups where the method is designed to create a future decision. For example, say that a facilitation is put together because a highway is going to go right through Beverly Hills in California. And Beverly Hills is unhappy about it, and the highway people want it, and somebody else is unhappy. And so they all get together to try to facilitate a discussion of how this might be done. I use that as a real example because it did happen and nothing came of it, unfortunately. There may be a facilitation that deals with work design. In that case, the stakeholders are those who are involved, let's say, in reorganizing a company. And they're designing what their new environment, their new work environment is going to be like. And there could be facilitation set up for mesh, for decision making just generally. One that's sort of fun is one that a writer named Edward de Bono, rather, I'll get his name right, created called Six Thinking Hats. And the technique was that he gave each of six participants or each of six groups colored hats, so that blue was rational, red was the assertive one, and they all met with those characteristics. They had to live up to their characteristics based on their color as a group to try to discuss how to make a decision, and it would be facilitated by a facilitator. I've never seen that work, but it sounds like it could be fun. There are all sorts of elements of facilitation. The facilitator is not a negotiator per se. The facilitator really is a moderator, for lack of a better word. And it's important, whoever it is, that that person set it up in a way that the facilitation is successful. Generally, they found that facilitations from the top down, where the company bosses say, we're going to have a meeting, we're going to facilitate this issue, and this is what we're going to discuss, that's not as successful as one from the bottom up, where, and I'm sure you've all seen them, everybody gets together in a room, they all put issues on a whiteboard, they then go into groups, there's a facilitator who circles the groups, making sure they're talking, sometimes they rotate so that each one discusses a different topic for 10 minutes, there are all sorts of ground rules, and Then they come back together again with their results and attempt to reach a consensus based on the results that have come out of it. There are a couple of books on it. There's the World Cafe, which was one of the early facilitation groups. They sat around coffee tables up in Napa Valley. There's a book by Owen called Open Space, and Mr. Owen was one of those who picks up about $10,000, I'm told, per day for facilitating, so there is money in it. He's not a mediator. All he does is put the groups together. He even in his book tells you how many pencils to bring, how many pads. It's really detailed. There is an International Association of Facilitators, and it's a whole area of group facilitation, which you should know about, although it's tangential, as I say, to negotiation per se. And it can work very well. I've been in a couple of them. I've actually run one little one, but I've been in a couple of them. One was an absolute horror. The parties were very antagonistic. It was a nonprofit organization. The facilitator lost control and they actually threw the facilitator out before it was over. I saw another one, which was between two governmental bodies, one of which I was on, where everybody had a lot of respect for the other side. One was a legislative body, one was an agency. And it was a very successful facilitation where everybody sort of expressed their views. And we learned a lot about the processes on the other side. So it is an area, it's normally, it's a multi-party type of a relationship. It's sort of sui generis. It's something to think about in the same way that it really involves a third-party intervener. It is sometimes brought up in mediation classes, just like Oz Bunn's person is a third-party intervener on behalf of whoever the complainants are in that sort of a situation. But I think it's worth mentioning in a negotiation course because it leads generally to multi-party negotiation between the parties who have been brought together to facilitate. So that's why I brought it up here.